Okay, let's start. Welcome to today's webinar on menopause trends in the workplace over the last 12 months. I'm very excited to be chatting to Dipali Nangia today from Speed Invest. This is the first part of a two-part series that we have prepared for you ahead of Menopause Awareness Month in October. And although today's focus will be on menopause in the workplace, if you have an interest in more clinical sessions, fret not, we have some amazing sessions lined up for you later in the year. So whether you care about HR or HRT, we've got you covered. So I'm Celine Crawford. I'm going to be your host for today. I run the people and operations function at Fertifa. If you are new to Fertifa, we are Europe's leading reproductive health benefits provider, and we work very closely with employers, with people teams, HR leaders such as yourself to create more inclusive and accessible workplace for employees. I'm so happy to moderate this talk today. Like many of us at Fertifa, we have a personal journey, a personal story with reproductive health, and having been on the chief people officer side as well, you can say that I've experienced both sides of the reproductive health coin. But before I introduce our amazing guest today, Dipali Nangia from Speed Invest, a couple of housekeeping points. So as you can see, this webinar is being recorded. If you want to share information or ask questions or have examples, try not to use any identifiable information. And although the Q&A will be anonymous, you will see the bottom box next to the participants, the chat box, if you would wish to chat to us, which we hope you will, because we want this to be engaging, is not anonymous. So just be mindful of those two things. And we are going to be following up with a recording after this. Now, Dipali, welcome to this webinar.
Thanks, Celine. Thank you for having me and very excited to speak to everybody who's joined today, like you said, during the lunch hour.
Absolutely, absolutely. So before I let you introduce yourself properly, I did want to tell everyone you are a partner at Speed Invest. Speed Invest is a pan-European early stage VC fund, and I wanted to share with our audience three things about you. So first, before Speed Invest, you co-founded Alma Angels, which is a community set up to increase the number of female angel investors in Europe for female-founded companies, which is absolutely amazing. And I know you've also invested and mentored multiple female-founded companies, such as PensionBee, Planera, Sanogenetics. And in 2021 alone, Dipali, you won the UK BAA's Angel Investor Award of the Year. So well done on that. That's absolutely amazing. And last but not least, I'm really proud to say that you are an investor in Fertifa as well. So I do want to share that with everyone. Can you tell us a little bit more about your work?
Absolutely. So exactly like you said, Celine, I've been, to be honest, investing and working with women for the last 8 years. As long as I can remember, I started investing in female founders, trying to build large scalable companies, and therefore obviously invested in Eileen. I'm a big fan of you and Eileen and the whole team at Fertifa. Started with areas where I feel I can have an impact and that have an impact on society. So I did a lot of investing in climate, in women's health, in education, in financial inclusion. And that's how I started my investment journey. Of course, along the way, want to see more women on cap tables and therefore set up Alma Angels because we've seen that women invest in, you know, other women. So wanted to create that flywheel. And that's what that's how we started Alma. And that's why we started it. And now partner at Speed Invest, again, with the focus on female founders. I invest in women at the fund. And women's health is actually a topic very, very close to my heart. I think I started investing in women's health 5 or 6 years ago because it's an under-researched, under-invested area. It's almost like an arbitrage opportunity in my view. So I have invested as an angel investor in companies, whether it was menopause or whether it was personalized contraceptives, or I've also invested in endometriosis. So I've kind of invested in the whole spectrum of businesses in women's health because, you know, I can go on and on about it, but happy to do it during the course of the webinar. But why?
Absolutely. I mean, more. You are such a perfect person for this webinar. Obviously, I know because you have the investor perspective and your experience with female founders, but I guess also your personal experience. So I'm hoping that we'll get to hear a little bit of both of these today. But before we begin, here at Fertifa, we absolutely love data. And so we like to start every webinar with a poll just to get us going and warmed up. So I'm going to ask people to vote if they are happy to do so. And I'm going to be launching the poll now. And the poll is as follows. Does your workplace have menopause support in place? Yes, no, or you don't know. I'm going to give people a few minutes and then we can discuss what we see. Oh, interesting. That is actually really impressive. I'm going to share with you in a sec. I'm just giving it another moment just to make sure that everybody has voted. So the results are that 59%, actually 60% now, are saying yes, they do have menopause support in place. 27% say no, and a proportion are saying that they don't know. I'm going to end the poll now. That's really interesting, actually. If we look at NHS data, the NHS most recent surveying of employers has shown that only 33% of employers are equipped to support menopausal women. But I think what we're seeing here today is that the people who are joining the webinar in a way already are invested in that journey to help people, employers, employees with menopause. So that is very, very good to see.
But would be interesting to learn from them what, you know, how the experience has been and how we can help them make it better. You know what
absolutely,
I mean?
Absolutely. Hopefully we'll get lots of questions in the Q&A later. So we're here today to discuss the trends that we've seen in menopause workplaces over the last year, and also to discuss the future of menopause. So we're going to be covering three trends today. The first trend, Dipali, is what we're seeing. More employers are prioritizing menopause support and policies, which is great, which we've seen in this poll. And research by Adzuna Job Ads cites that menopause leave has doubled to attract and retain the best workers. So Dipali, why do you think this trend is happening? And is this something that you're seeing as well?
Yeah, because I think, you know, it's very important that we are supportive of our employees, right? So because a happier and employee is just, you know, somebody who's taken care of, just is a more productive employee, right? So we have noticed this increasing trend to support women and other categories of employees in the workplace with menopause, with reproductive health, with family health, etc. Definitely an increasing trend because it's almost like an employee benefit that that was latent that we weren't using, and now it's being used for recruitment and retention. And in the case of menopausal women, I think it's, you know, it is a slightly older woman who has probably been at the company for longer, you know, and if you look at retraining costs, you know, if they leave, retraining costs tend to be quite high. We've also seen some cases that have gone to tribunal, to be honest, on menopause. You definitely don't want those tribunal costs. And lastly, there's also, you know, a cost of absence, right? So if you can support them better, then that cost of absence also goes down. So in my view, to the business is just a positive benefit from introducing menopause support.
Yeah, absolutely. And as we know, reproductive health includes the highest instances of health inequalities that we see about age, race, gender, sexual orientation. And so if we want to be seen as diversity and inclusion leaders in the workplace, it is so important to make sure that we have those practices and those policies in place, as well as general education. So I completely agree with what you're saying. And we know that the UK government at the moment is focusing on keeping over 50s in the workforce, and menopause support is a crucial part of that, but it's often being ignored. Why do you think that is, Dipali?
I mean, I think there's obviously this taboo around menopause, right? How many women actually want to come out? And I think it's quite different from pregnancy, which is a very visible, like, you know, when you're pregnant, you know, it's quite a standard procedure. You go to your antenatal appointments. I think men know because many of them have had children. So they kind of know that the journey that a woman is going to go through, right? Every woman's journey is, of course, different. But I think it's in the case of pregnancy, it's been going on for so long. You go, you do your appointments, then they know that you're going to take time off. And you know what? Highly likely you might return to work or you might not, but the journey is quite well known, as opposed to menopause, which is like several years. Every woman is completely different. I can talk about myself and my symptoms, but you know, every woman is completely different. And there is this taboo. How many women actually feel comfortable talking to their managers about menopause, right? And if you don't talk about it, nobody will know about it. I feel like I'm perimenopausal. I can openly say that now. And I've had these discussions with, you know, people I'm close to at the office, men and women. And I remember I called HR and I said, can I please have a fan? Because of course, there was a woman on the receiving end. And I was like, I really need a fan because I'm feeling hot. I called a friend, I called Eileen. And I was like, tell me what I need to do. And she was like, oh, this is the gel and you can use this at night. But my husband obviously doesn't know it either. You know, he's never like, I don't think he's ever discussed this with his mother. So for him, it was like with a fan right on my face at night. He was like a bit annoyed. And I was like, you have to understand that I'm going through these symptoms, but these are the discussions you need to have. And how many women are okay with having those discussions, right? Sorry, I saw
absolutely
something up in the chat.
Yeah, no, I can see the chat. Mary is saying, I'm often the first woman people speak to who has gone through the menopause, at least the first who is open about it. And it's been so helpful to share experiences and open minds. And I mean, that is absolutely amazing and important, and really brings us to the second trend, which is, you know, menopausal women are the fastest growing demographic in the workplace. So that is a fact according to the NHS. And so workplace education is so important. Often we have people, unlike pregnancy, who are going through menopause at completely different ages. They have completely different symptoms. Some people might feel things severely. Mm-hmm. Some people might just feel a few symptoms. Some people are in perimenopause for a little while. Some people are straight into menopause. And so I feel more and more people are going to the employer looking for some answers. So why do you think workplace education is so important? And I guess from your perspective as an investor as well, you know, what impact can employers see from meaningful change that they're implementing?
I mean, obviously, the longer the employee has been there, the more institutional knowledge they have in their head, and they're more, you know, they're just more valuable to you, right? So if a woman has been around for a long time and she's now menopausal, the cost of then losing her and retraining someone else is quite high, right? Secondly, I also feel that, you know, again, I don't know how many people have tried to access NHS services. You know, I know like a year ago, many women were going private because there was a huge backlog in NHS services, right? Because primary care is not capable of fulfilling that demand. So at some case, in my view, the onus is on the employer to pick up this, you know, to play a role in helping elevate some of this, you know, public healthcare burden.
Absolutely, absolutely. And as you've mentioned previously, you know, there is an impact on happiness, but also importantly, from a business perspective, on productivity and on retention. You know, 41% of menopausal women, they struggle to stay on top of their work, according to the Latte Lounge. And, you know, almost the same number consider actually leaving work. And that is, you know, a big problem, Dipali. Do you agree?
Yes, 100% today, actually. And brain fog, by the way, because I feel it all the time. I was like, I met this company 3 weeks ago. I love them. I can't remember the name. And then all the men in my office started Googling that business in Africa. It was like a maternal health business that I was looking at just to help me out, because I can't remember the name of this company. Can't remember it in my inbox. So, I mean, these are real symptoms. These are not, and you know, they're recurring. And they come at all different times of the day. And they come for several years. And I'm super productive. I'm one of those people who works like 12, 13 hours a day, and I'm completely going at it. But even I feel like I'm suffering from these symptoms, and I don't think that my employer would like to lose me. Do you know what I mean? I think it is the need to be able to support women, because I think, and others, like I know this is not a free, I think you are also supporting a man, because I think the manager needs to learn about this. So I think you're also supporting many men and educating many men, because all this is just easier if the men are on board.
Absolutely. And that's one of the things we do at Fertifa is often work with managers to help train them on education and even, you know, asking, not assuming, because as I said in the beginning, we may have gone through a reproductive health journey and we assume that we know what someone else is feeling, but someone else might be having a completely different experience. And I love that you said that you asked for a desk fan. I do want to ask you a kind of a question following that. So, you know, we always joke a little bit, you know, for equal pay day, women don't want cupcakes. For menopause, we don't just want desks fan. You know, what else do you think would have helped you, you know, when you realized that you were having these symptoms?
Yeah,
and would have made you work better?
Yeah, you mean education, obviously, right? Because the first thing you turn to is like, how can I alleviate the symptoms? So if there was something that I could quickly refer to and be like, oh, these are the foods you need to take, or these are the, you know, you need to avoid alcohol, because that's the first thing that comes to me is like, how do I learn more about this? You know, is my skin going to change? Is my hair going to change? Is my bone density going to change? Am I going to be more susceptible to cardiovascular, right? So I think all those questions. And of course, I went to see a doctor to, you know, a private doctor, right? Mm-hmm. To be like, I spent an hour with that doctor. How many primary care doctors are going to give me an hour of the time to like answer all these questions for me? I actually don't know the answer, but I would think probably nobody, right? So
yes,
for me, that education, just like pregnancy, the first time I was pregnant, I had all these questions and I picked up a book. I picked up What to Expect When You're Expecting, and I read it back to back and I asked all these new mothers. But to be honest, I don't know many menopausal women around me. Our workforce is really young. At the office, none of my friends are menopausal yet, right? So for me, and my mom has passed away, so I'm just like, who do I talk to about this and how do I learn more about this? So then I obviously reach out to friends like Eileen and, you know, others who might or might not be going through the same journey. But I think educating your employee base, having resources for them, having someone to talk to, you know, who they can reach out to, I would love that.
Yeah, absolutely. And everything that you're saying is supporting the third trend that we're seeing. According to a Mercer report, employers are ranked second for the source of employees to trust the most to deliver high quality, convenient, affordable health solutions. And this was ranked higher than a virtual consultation, for example, and the public healthcare system. So, I mean, we say all the time at Fertifa, we're so lucky to have a public healthcare system in the country. However, the NHS is overwhelmed and more and more employees are going to their employers looking for education, looking for options, looking for answers. And you touched on it a little bit, but why do you think, I guess also from an investor perspective, the employer-funded model is here to stay and the solution for menopause support?
Yeah, because of the NHS, I find that many women don't go private, right? They just tend to wait longer until their symptoms become worse, because A, there's this backlog, right? And you can't see a doctor immediately. We also know there have been like HRT shortages like last year, et cetera, right? So I feel like you spend so much of your time at the office. I spend 12 hours at the office. I give so much to my employer. I feel it's only fair that the employer picks up a part of this, the cost of this burden, right? And it ensures that I'm getting timely, accurate care with outcomes that make me a more productive, happier employee. So in my view, it's just simple. It's like, who is going to help solve this NHS crisis?
Yes, absolutely. And I'm reading what's being said in the chat at the moment about, you know, Mary in this case, who became the menopause champion at work, which I think is absolutely wonderful. However, how can employers make sure that this goes beyond just one individual? Because it's quite a big burden that you become the menopause champion. And let's say you were to leave, or let's say, you know, you weren't going through, you know, a great phase personally in your life. You cannot, you know, just be that one person. So from your experience working with companies, what have you seen that works?
Yeah, I mean, obviously menopause champion is really good, and to have more than one champion is really good, but obviously she has gone through menopause herself and can be an authentic champion, right? Because people want to, just like in pregnancy, you'll talk to a new mom because she will have more valuable information for you than anybody else because she's going through it herself, right? So somebody who's gone through it is going to be the right champion. Having said that, I think there's a lot of line manager training here required, right? I really think that you need to have men on board here. Men need to understand that it's not taboo, that it's only normal, that 50% of the population or less, slightly less, is going to go through this. And women are not small men. Women are just different. You know, women are, and you need to understand what they're going through.
I love this.
Hormonally, so you can be able to support them.
Yes, we are not small men, you know, that is absolutely right. You know, we are completely different individuals and we have different hormones that work in a different way. And so I completely agree with what you're saying. So those were the three trends that we wanted to discuss that we're seeing in the last 12 months working with companies. Now thinking a little bit more about the future of menopause, obviously, where are we going towards? I know you and I, am I right in saying we have daughters as children, right? So let's first think about, you know, the next 5 years. Before getting there, what is important to implement now? And where do we see this going in the next 5 years?
I mean, very important that we have the support policies in place. We understand what women are going through. We make sure they have access to clinical support. They have access to prescriptions. You know, they have access to everything that is needed to so they can continue living their lives on a normal daily basis, right? And a lot of it is also educating people that this needs to be done. And I have a daughter. And to be honest, I feel like when I was growing up, period was like such a taboo topic. I remember going down the road in India and buying like sanitary pads and like putting them in this brown paper bag and carrying them. And it was like such a big deal, as opposed to my daughter, for whom this is completely normal, right, to have the period. So I think over time it's going to get more and more normalized, but we need to speak about it.
Yeah.
We need to be like, if we didn't speak about having the vote, we would never have the vote. If we didn't shout about having the vote, we would never have the vote. So we need to, I think, as women, be supportive of other women. We might not be going through it, but we need to make sure that women who are going through it are supported through this process, right? Which means talking to HR, making sure the corporate policies, as leaders, we want to make sure that the corporate policies are in place, right?
Absolutely. So that is exactly what Eve is saying. So she's saying one of the massive issues is that the corporate policies, they don't cover the reproductive health. And so we at Fertifa always help companies mold reproductive health policies. And, you know, you don't need massive budgets. You don't need pages and pages. I think what people want, they want to understand the clarity around the different situations that they might face, whether they're going through a fertility journey or they're going through menopause. They want to know if they can work flexibly, if, you know, things happen. And who do they go to if they want to ask more questions? And so sometimes that's the simplest place to start, but still we're seeing companies are not starting. So what's your advice there?
I mean, honestly, I think it is foolish not to think of return on investment here, right? When I just think of women who are going to leave the workforce because of menopause and the impact that it has on your business from a cost perspective, it makes no sense to me to not be supportive of this, right? So that's where I would start. I would look at your workforce, what percentage of women in there, are reaching menopausal age. And to be honest, I believe it's more reproductive health. It's not just menopause. You need to just have everything. You need to have like maternity, pre-maternity, you need to have like, you know, reproductive right from the start, and then postnatal, you know, how can I support a woman through postnatal? And then that's how you increase the lifetime value of the, I guess, of your employee. And I guess in this case, who is your customer? That's how you make sure as an employer, you're holding on to this person through their career.
Absolutely. I completely agree with you. And something that is told to us a lot when clients or HR leaders come to speak to us is, you know, how do you get leadership buy-in? You know, how do you get the leadership team to feel that it is important to have these policies in place? And, you know, you've worked with a lot of female-founded businesses, but also male-founded businesses, you know, what is your perspective
Always, I think it's always data-driven, right? It's a cost exercise and it's like a benefit exercise, right? So you have to survey your population and be like, what percentage of women will benefit from this? In, you know, and certain companies have close to 50% of their population that are, might be of that age or might need at some point the menopause service, right? Or support. So I think it's a matter of, if it's like 2% of the population, then I would say that, you know what, it's hard to get buy-in. But 30%, 40% of the population, then you need to be able to show the exactly the cost-benefit analysis in terms of days that people are absent. You know, what if they left? What are the retraining costs? I mean, these are very easy to calculate in my view,
absolutely,
right?
It's
a question of then asking for that budget and making sure that you're allocating that budget appropriately.
Yeah, absolutely. So Claire is saying, you know, where do you start? They're a small business with 300 employees, 45% women. That's significant, of varying ages, and they would love tips where to start. I mean, personally, from experiences as a chief people officer, but also working with companies, I think the buy-in is quite important. Mm-hmm. And you're right, you know, surveying the data internally. But I think it's important to have policies, even if you don't have a big menopausal population of women, just to explain how to attract more, you know, people to your business. Absolutely. Women are experienced. Absolutely. They've worked for 100%. Several years. They have, you know, a bank of knowledge that they bring with them. But what tips would you have?
Yeah, but that is harder. That is a harder sale, in my view, than if the population already exists.
Of course, of course. You know? 100%. Yeah.
So obviously, you would start exactly at that point by serving the population. And in this case, if there's women of varying ages, then I would really start with the reproductive health to a menopause. I would look at something that offers the whole stack, because that is an easier sell, because it's more inclusive than segmenting a certain population of your workforce, right? Something that goes all the way through is what I would try and buy here.
Yeah, absolutely. I think also what's good is, you know, we had some people say that they were champions. I think, you know, if you create a work group that's coming from your DEI committee, if you have one, I think having people working together and starting to raise awareness, which you can do even with no budget. You can, for example, have people talk about their personal experience, whether they want to do this anonymously or not anonymously. It has a really big impact. You can invite guest speakers to start, and also, you know, helping educate, you know, different people and raising awareness on the issue.
And that's exactly right, because we did this with paternal leave. We also did this with miscarriage. And, you know, we actually got together as women in the organization and put it forward. Obviously, we're a smaller company, so sometimes it's easier to do. But we've done it with, like, paternal leave, maternal leave, miscarriage. We've also done it with, like, reimbursement or some nursery costs, you know, as in, like, this is how it would benefit our employee base, and it has worked in our case.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, in the fertility space, we often see also the rise, it's quite new, of a fertility officer that is separate from your HR person. And so in this case, you could have someone that's a reproductive health officer or menopause officer that will understand what's going on with you and that can help you. There's a few questions here about, you know, sick leave, menopause leave. I think what we've seen is a lot of companies have separate policies that are away from the sick leave policy, but that will allow you to say you can take X amount of days off for menopause, you can log it as other absence, this is the maximum number of days that you can have. Other companies are more lax and say, you know, it's kind of a, you know, let us know how much you need and we'll give it to you scenario. So it is very, very different. But the question that was following up is also about male-dominated industry, right? So a lot of us work in male-dominated industries or have worked in male-dominated industries, and I'm sure Dipali in the investment world as well.
Male-dominated.
You know, thinking about your journey, what do you think would have helped to bring this to the fore, you know, more prominently? Or did you have very supportive executives?
Yeah, we do have very supportive male leadership. I will say that for sure. But I think it's finding that we also have a female leader. Right. We have a female general partner at the fund who I talk to about most things. You know, I have spoken to her about going through, like, when I met her last, I said, I'm feeling hot. I'm having these hot flashes. What did you do at night, you know, when you were going through this? So I have had this discussion. Right. So I think it's finding those female leaders in the organization. And to be honest, I will openly have this discussion with our CEO, who's male, but not everybody can do that. But I will identify those female leaders who can get behind you, because it is to the benefit of all women to work together on these policies, especially in male-dominated industries. I mean, ideally, you would also find those male champions, the many men who are champions of women, right? Find those male champions to root for you.
Absolutely. Male allies are so important for this. There's a question here about, you know, companies that work globally in different locations and how do you service those companies? So there are different models. So at Fertifa, for example, we are a global provider, but we have seen companies who want to take a localized approach to their parental leave or their reproductive health leave. What have you seen from your experience, Dipali?
Yeah, exactly that. There are some localized providers. I know Fertifa does, you know, we do. So many other countries in Europe as well. But I think it's important that whoever you choose as a provider understands if it's not a local, because look, there are local nuances when it comes to, like, local clinics, local doctors, local healthcare system. I think whoever you choose should be able to understand and service the local geography. Obviously, you would want as an HR leader to have one provider, right, for all your geos, but you don't find that. very often. You know, we've had this whole slew of American companies that were doing it in America, and then we have one in Germany that I met that was doing it for Germany. Fatifa does it, you know, trying to do across EU. As an HR manager, it would be make my life more easier if it was one provider. Services.
Absolutely. Yeah. And, you know, sometimes it's led by the employees. So what we see is that specific employees in specific jurisdictions will ask or want to work with specific clinics. And so then that becomes part of the offering, you know, is vetted by the provider that you're working with. And so it's kind of a two-way street, I would say.
Yeah.
Great. This is great, Dipali. I did have a couple of questions that are not necessarily in this ballpark, but something that I'm very passionate about is, for example, the gender pension gap, and also, you know, having more executive women at the table. You know, how do you think having menopause policies in place can help support that? Because as we are today, when women retire, you know, they are earning less than men, and it's still a big equality. And so by being able to support women while they are going through menopause so that they don't take such long absences, can be at the executive table, do you see that will have a positive impact?
I mean, 100%, because they are less likely to leave the workforce, right? They're less likely to leave the workforce. They feel more supported, and career progression is more natural. Like, you're not discriminated against because you're menopausal, right? It's not a disability. It's something we're going through, which is hormonally an issue, which will get better over time. And we have to make sure that we have, you know, support in place to help that. So if you're not leaving the workforce early, you are going to have less of a gender pension gap, or a, you know, even gender pay gap with career progression. You can't be discriminated against, right, here in this case. So obviously you will have more women at the table because the women are not leaving. Those experienced women will stay on.
Yes, absolutely. Absolutely. And something else that I've been very interested in, and I hope you won't mind that I say this, but obviously I'm from Lebanon. Dipali, you are from India. So we are considered minorities. And there's been a very interesting data that's come out by the Wellbeing of Women that showed that 51% of women surveyed going through menopause felt that the support was too focused on the experience of white women.
Yeah.
What do you think about that?
Yeah, that is so interesting, because I think people of color, marginalized communities, tend to get left out of many things. I mean, women are left out of clinical trials to a huge degree, and people of color are left out even more, right? So I think it's because there are not as many maybe senior women who are from marginalized communities or people of color. So therefore, they tend to naturally, you know what I mean? If you don't see it, then you don't kind of include
Absolutely.
It.
Absolutely. You can't be what you can see in a way.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So if you're not seeing those senior women, then it's less likely that. So some of it is not intentional. Some mm-hmm. of it is because they're just not present in that population. So you don't know how to serve them. Some of it is not understanding their needs. Like, I know, you know, even when it comes to reproductive health, infant mortality with Black women is higher than it is with white women, right? So when we're offering services around, you know, women in hospitals, we have to take into account that they are different and they need to be taken care of differently. So the baby is, you know, still okay. So we have to, some of it is we are not doing it right. Some of it is not intentional because they're just not part of that senior population, is what I'm saying. But yeah,
absolutely.
I can see why people would say that.
Yeah. So Dipali, before we move to the official Q&A part,
Wow.
I did want to ask you, you know, where do you see, you know, the future of healthcare in general? Maybe personally, where would you hope it to be for our daughters when they are working?
Yeah.
It might be a few years away, but, you know, time goes so quickly. So we have to start acting now. So tell me what you see.
My daughter actually wants to be a surgeon, strangely. So she will definitely be working in the healthcare system. I think it's, you know, personalized healthcare, which is right for me. Exactly like you said, I'm a brown woman of a certain age, and I need to, you know, the doctor needs to understand that cardiovascular risk is higher for my population, bone density issues, you know, because maybe my mother had osteoporosis or whatever. It is personalized medicine for each individual with good, you know, which leads to like better outcomes, probably a hybrid healthcare system, which is part digital, part, you know, going to the clinic, because there are many things that you can triage, just like we do through Fatifa. You know, we can have cases that don't need to, you know, have more than a few clinical sessions, don't need acute care and some of that triage. So a good hybrid healthcare system, lots of employer support in issues where the public healthcare system is struggling to keep up. You know, this is where I feel it needs to be cheaper, more accessible, and have better outcomes. That is what ideally I would like to see.
Absolutely, absolutely. Thank you so much. So if you would like to ask a question now, I know you've already been doing that. So thank you so much, everyone. But feel free to put your question in the Q&A box before we continue, and I will read it out loud. Let's see what we have.
There's one around business, around coaching.
Yes, so this is for Deepali. In your view, why do you think the employer-funded model is the future of healthcare? I think, you know, you've answered that already. Yeah. So Mary, so we have another question. What is one thing firms should do first?
I mean, depends on what you mean. What is one thing? I'm assuming when it relates to menopause, it should really try and understand your population, right? Understand the employee base. Like I said, our population at the fund is mostly 25 and 26 year old. So it's slightly different. So for us, a reproductive health offering is more interesting than a menopause offering. Although I would like all of it. So I and other, you know, 2-3 other women can access the menopause bit. But I think it's serving your population and the needs of the population, right? Trying to understand what your employees want is the most important thing before you are willing to make any change. You need to understand the data.
Yes, absolutely. Because even as we said, within a menopausal group of women, they might want different things. So exactly. You need to make sure that you know, you can't just do this in an isolation. Yeah. You need to get feedback, and you know, starting with a survey is always a good idea, or starting with a work group where you know you create a psychological safety. Of course, that goes without saying, so that people feel that they're willing to share is very important. So there's another question here. We're limited by budget and resource. Would you prioritize menopause support ahead of something like fertility support because it impacts more people?
Again, it depends on your employee population, right? Yeah. I think it's different for different employers. Depends on the age. So I can't answer this question without knowing more about whether fertility is better. And in any case, for TIFA, we offer everything, whether it's fertility or menopause. You can start with one module and over time build another module. So if you feel like you have a, you know, population that is younger right now that will grow into a menopausal offering, I will probably start with fertility and then, you know, move on to a menopause offering.
Exactly. So what we see a lot working with clients is that they will come to see us for, let's say, one theme or one subject that they'd like help with, but they know that we are able to offer everything. And then as they mature as a company, as the company grows, they start coming to us for, you know, different theme and, you know, men's health or any reproductive health issues. And so if you can work with someone like Fertifa, that's great. But I think in this case, you know, limited budget and resource, you know, it goes back to education. So it is important to be able to disseminate that information as much as you can. So we have another question. I've not experienced menopause, but I manage a team of women in their 40s. I was wondering what the symptoms are of perimenopause and how severe that can be for people whilst working. What should I be aware of as a manager?
Yeah, I mean, to be honest, I feel like I'm perimenopausal and my symptoms might be, again, symptoms are so different for different women. My symptoms have been like feeling really hot at night. I used to wake up with these like night sweats, really like really, really hot. Suddenly you're feeling hot and suddenly you're like feeling cold. It was a bit odd. And then obviously feeling hot during the day, which is why I got a fan. I sit next to the window for that reason. I open the window in the office, and I think it really helps me get some fresh air in. I think also sometimes in meetings, you start feeling really hot. So you're in the middle of like pitching to a client and you're feeling like really hot and you start feeling anxious. Of course, I've had slightly less of those. I shouldn't say this because I'm sure tomorrow this is exactly what's going to happen to me. Women feel anxious and also a lot of brain fog. You kind of like forget. You're like, who did I meet like an hour ago? Like, what was the name of that person? Like, I can't remember that piece of information, right?
So, yeah. I think, you know, it's, you know, again, the symptoms can really vary depending on the individual. You know, we know that some people start their menopause very early, some people start perimenopause early, and it will come from the list of symptoms. You know, the periods are becoming irregular, and, you know, it is very, very different and not, unfortunately, a one size fits all. So people just have to ask the right questions and try to get education.
But I love that you're managing a team. And to be honest, thinking about this, because this is exactly what you need to be thinking about in order to be a supportive manager and a good leader and motivate them, you know, because I feel some of it is just showing that you care makes a huge difference in any employee's life. Like, think about your best employees and how you could motivate them even more, or not just best, but even if you show somebody who's not as good that you care, you feel like there's a switch. You know what I mean? As humans, we always want that, you know, want to be cared for. That is just a natural instinct.
Absolutely. I absolutely love this question around coaching for challenges that occur at menopause. So, for example, confidence building, mental health, career development, you know, with so many women opting out of the workplace. And I'd be really interested in your view, obviously, as an investor in female founded businesses. You know, do you think that's something, you know, that can really help with the performance of businesses and the general performance in general to support in that way?
I mean, I think that we offer as a company a coaching service, right? Mm-hmm. Now, whether I use it for confidence building or mental health or career development is up to me. And whether I'm menopausal or not, you know, I can probably use these services even if I'm not menopausal, is what I'm saying, right? But of course, it might apply in helping me deal better with some of the challenges that I'm going through at this point in time around. But I also feel that you need to see someone more clinical as well. I feel like this is not just a confidence building mental health thing for me at this point as a menopausal woman or a perimenopausal. It really is about how do I deal with my symptoms? How do I alleviate my symptoms to make me more productive? Mm-hmm. So this is not just for me about confidence building and mental health at this stage.
Yeah, I mean, they are related because, you know, we are people going through this. I think in the beginning, when you don't have this information and you're not sure what's happening to you, it can be quite helpful. I think some companies do have training budgets, for example, as part of learning and development. So even though that's not related to menopause, you know, people should be using those to, you know, get coaching if they can in their companies.
And talk to other women, you know, there's nothing like talking to other women who are going through it. I feel we always forget that, you know, we are, as a community, as a sisterhood, we can be really supportive of each other.
100%. That's so important. And I think what's really beautiful to see, you know, we talked about male allies, but women allies, right? So personally, when I was going through the investment banking days growing up, you know, women were not necessarily always your allies. And so it's so good to see and find women allies that can talk to you openly and support you through any journey, whether it's in your company or outside of your company. There are so many groups that you can join and, you know, working with companies like us, you know, just to help the education. I really like the next question. Given the current state of the market and a lot of companies letting go of employees and reducing their wellness benefit budget, do you have any concerns around the direct-to-employer distribution strategy?
I mean, I think you will do what is right to retain the employees that makes sense for you to retain as a business, right? This is a business decision. And I think that, in my view, this is a long-term investment. I don't look at it as this is the state of the market. Of course, there will be budget cuts, right? But these cycles happen all the time. But, you know, women will stay in the workforce forever. So for me, this is not a what happens in this cycle, what mm-hmm. is going to happen, in my view, overall in the long run. I think these policies need to stay. Whether they're slightly reduced now might be the case. Again, it's a business case to make, but in my view, it's a no-brainer question. But there's one that you missed, Celine, which was right before. We have a menopause.
Right. We have a menopause policy in place, but this is centered around leave and flexible working. Our team is hybrid, but what are the practical changes we should be making to support people through menopause?
Yeah, I mean, I think having a menopause support in place, so like education for the workforce, as well as making sure they have access to clinicians, you know, access to people that they can talk to, like a clinical team. So it's not just, you know, so they can access it from home as well. Something virtual that they can access from home as well.
Yeah, absolutely. I think it's so important with policies in general to make sure, because some companies have policies, but you have to have practicalities around the policies. They have to fit the workforce that you have, and you have to be allowed to use the policy. So sometimes we've seen work that have loads of policies, but nobody is using them at the exact level. They're just, you know, there to kind of tick a box. And so it is very important to show that these policies are lived and remind and inform employees that they are there. How can they use them? Be really clear about what they can and can't do. And if the policy is not fit for purpose, ask for feedback. You know, these are living, breathing documents that we should be reviewing on a yearly basis. And so, you know, we won't get it right first time. That's fine. I think they should grow and live with us. So I'm going to leave time for a couple more questions.
There's one more. Do you think menopause support?
Yes.
I love that one.
Yes.
It'll become like a standard benefit. And that's exactly what I think it should become, which is why I go back to the question before, which was, you know, the current state of the market. My dental benefit has not gone away. I can tell you that. I neither have my health benefit. So I think that's exactly how menopause benefit, reproductive health benefit, family health benefit. This, in my view, should sit on top of your health insurance benefit, just like dental does, and it should be here to stay forever.
Yeah, absolutely. We actually have a question in the main chat about UK corporate policies, including menopause, for example, AXA, they won't cover. That's absolutely right. A lot of these, you know, big insurers don't actually cover. We work with Aviva, they cover fertility, but that's why we exist. We exist to make sure that there is this availability. And the hope is that, you know, you are serviced, you know, from one way or another. So Deepali, any final thoughts before we say goodbye?
I mean, I would just say that in my view, 50% of the population has been underserved for way too long, right? And I feel like we need to be supportive in order to be productive and happier employees. We spend so much time to work. We give so much to work, you know, that we need, in my view, this should be standard on top of your healthcare. Like, I have no doubt in my mind that's where we're heading, which is why we invested in Fertipa. And I can't wait for it to become a really big company for that
exact reason. Absolutely. Very exciting times ahead. So I really want to thank you, Deepali, for joining us today. I also wanted to highlight to everyone in the audience, thank you for joining. I have put in the chat our next part of the series around menopause, if you would like to sign up as well. This has been a really exciting chat, and I'm sure a lot of people took so much away from it. I know I have as well. So I really appreciate you taking the time. Thank you so much.
Thanks, Elaine. Thank you. Thank you, everybody who was listening. Bye-bye.
Bye, everyone.